It makes the bridge very fragile. It doesn't have an added value. The technician later in his lab can change those multi-units to whatever he wants. Depends on how long. In this case, that you have any other option.
Hi, and welcome back to Anika Dental Show, where we discuss interesting cases and new procedures. Hello, Yaniv. Welcome again.
Hi, Bo.
What did you bring for us today?
Yeah, well, today we brought a case that took very long time, from the start till the end. We started with a broken bridge, and we ended with bridge on implants. But what we want to show today is the process of the planning and the temporary bridges that we made all this time. And this is the interesting part of this case, because it's small bridge on three implants, nothing special, but the planning and everything we did is very interesting, and I think it has a place to be talked about.
When you said a long time, what is considered a long time?
Yeah, about 1.5 year. Maybe 2.
Wow.
Yeah, it's very much, but because we took the time and we did everything and gave time for everything, you'll see the changes, mostly in the soft tissues, that we managed to get a great result, and the only factor that we need to do is take time, in many times. You can't have all teeth in one day and that's all. The patient came with chipping in the crown, as you can see in the left slide.
That was her complaint?
Yeah, that was her complaint.
Okay.
She wanted to fix this, maybe add composite or something, and we made a scan, an x-ray, and we saw that it's not the only problem. The teeth underneath this bridge are with caries. We can't leave it like this because it won't hold any much longer. You can't take it out. There are no teeth.
So she came complaining about chipping.
Yeah, she came with small complaint, and she went home with a new bridge.
Like winning the lottery, but in reverse.
Yeah, something like this. So we took out the bridge. We saw the problematic teeth. We chose 3 teeth to extract, and we made a new temporary bridge. With this bridge, she went home. We left those teeth just for the bridge. Mm-hmm. In the end, we extracted all of the teeth, but we wanted something for the bridge to hold on. So that's why we left some, extracted some.
And they're strong enough to hold it?
Look, not the best, but it's quite good for this period of 1.5, 2 years to hold. So in the places of the extracted teeth, we placed implants for the permanent bridge. You can see that the temporary bridge without large separations, because we don't want the bridge to break down. We don't want to have large separations. It makes the bridge very fragile.
How many implants were placed?
3 implants in this.
In this step?
Yeah, in this step, 3 implants were placed in the places of the extracted teeth. Because the implants were placed in the place of the extracted teeth, the axis of the implant is like the axis of the tooth. So without guided surgery, we know that the screw channel of the bridge will go in the occlusal part and not the buccal part. If we've waited some time and there was a little bit of buccal resorption of the bone, we'll have a problem, because we'll need to place the implant in buccal inclination, and then we'll have a buccal screw channel.
In this particular case, you were talking about surgical guide.
Yeah.
You used surgical guide here?
No, we didn't need surgical guide. In this case, you don't need surgical guide because you extracted the tooth. You know the axis of the implant, because you need to place the implant in the axis of the tooth. And you have enough space between 2 teeth. So there are no problems in positioning of the implants. You know that probably you'll place the implants in a good position and you don't have any problems with this. So surgical guide just complicates the procedure and that doesn't have an added value.
I see the upper bridge not connected to the gingiva.
Yeah, when we're extracting teeth and we're waiting for the healing process, we don't want the bridge to press on the gingiva. It will have a negative effect. Mm-hmm. So in this case, we leave some little bit of space between the teeth and the gingiva. In this case, she'll be able to clean between the bridge and the gingiva.
By herself.
By herself, yeah. In the healing process, because like this she'll go home and she will be with this temporary bridge for about four or five months. Mm-hmm. So she need to clean it up. You can see as she came back with the healed gingiva, she didn't clean up the bridge very good, because you can see some plaque around the bridge.
Well, she came with rotten teeth to begin with.
Yeah, that's probably the cause why she came with the problematic teeth.
How long after the first bridge?
About 4 or 5 months.
So the gingiva healed this way in 4 months?
Yeah, it's healed about 4 or 5 months. She came back. In this case, we can take off the bridge and we can see the implants. Mm-hmm. You can see here the healing caps and you can see the implants themselves. So we took out the healing caps and we placed multi-units. We used 1 4-millimeter multi-units and 2 2-millimeter multi-units. We changed the multi-units to different ones, not so high, because we extracted the teeth, the gingiva changed, and we needed to change the multi-units. But in all of this process, she still have her temporary bridge that she went in the first place.
Mm-hmm. So she will always have teeth.
Yeah, she always goes out of the clinic with something temporary. In this case, she have temporary bridge. Right now, for example, she comes to the clinic, we take out the healing caps, mm-hmm. we insert multi-units, and we need to take impressions, right? So we take impressions and we make a new temporary bridge on those multi-units. But making a new bridge takes time. Mm-hmm. So we give her back the temporary bridge that she came with. In the meantime, we're making new bridge. The next time when she'll come, we'll extract those teeth and connect a new temporary bridge. And we'll wait again for the healing.
Another 4 months,
yeah. We want to take impressions. And then we need to have to give her back the bridge, because it takes time to make a new bridge. Mm-hmm. So we don't want to take out those multi-units, insert new ones, take impressions, return the old ones, and return the bridge. We can make it much more simple. Mm-hmm. We can take impressions on those multi-units.
The existing ones.
Yeah, the existing ones. That way, we just return the bridge. And that's all. We took impressions, we turned the bridge. Mm-hmm. But on the existing multi-units, you can see you have all the occlusal part of the multi-unit. It's not inside the gingiva. It's seen. You would want smaller multi-units, change almost all the multi-units.
Digitally, while the patient is at home.
Yeah, so with these multi-units and scan abutments, what we can do is we take, no matter on what multi-unit, the technician later in his lab can change those multi-units to whatever he wants. Mm-hmm. And he tells later the doctor, he told us, what multi-units we should use. Then the patient came back to us. We got out those multi-units, changed to new ones. And we already had a manufactured bridge on the new multi-units. So instead of taking out the multi-units, putting back new multi-units, taking out the new multi-units, putting back the old multi-units, the bridge, then taking out the old multi-units, putting back new multi-units, and the new bridge, yeah. We just did it once.
And the technician can do it digitally.
Yeah, and the technician did it digitally.
It's important to find a good technician.
You can see in the next photo, this is what we got. We got a new bridge. We replaced the multi-units. This one was left, we replaced those two. Mm-hmm. 1 to 2 millimeters, 1 to 1 millimeter. This was 2 millimeters, we changed to one. This one was 4 millimeters, we changed to two. Mm-hmm. And just inserted the bridge. This is the only time we changed multi-units. Inserted the bridge, close the holes. Now, in this case, you can see in the temporary bridge that we have all the gingiva. We have everything we need. Instead of just changing the bridge, we also add one crown for the aesthetics.
You did it cantilever style?
No, she had a tooth with the amalgam filling. And yeah, you can see in the previous photo, you can see this tooth is a little bit black. Mm-hmm. She didn't want it to look that way, so this tooth was crowned. In here you can see another crown and the bridge on the implants, and this was the final bridge. You can see the gingiva, everything looks great. In this case, what we had is, first of all, we didn't took off the multi-units and replaced them and had a lot of traumatic screen out, screen in. We had a temporary bridge made every time. So each time she went outside the clinic, she had something to left with.
Can the temporary bridge hold enough force, like normal daily routine pressure, even if it's not connected to the gingiva?
Yeah, it probably would hold, but depends on how long. These bridges were changed every 3-4 months. Mm-hmm. So with time, the temporary bridge changes its color a little bit, goes weaker a little bit. You want to change them periodically. Mm-hmm. In this case, we had 3 temporary bridges. We each time between different bridges waited to have proper healing, to have proper gingival contour, to know how the gingiva will react and to adjust the gingiva to the teeth. You can see the scalloping in the gingiva. It was made because the gingiva had some contact with the teeth.
How do you know to which patient applies this kind of procedure for 2 years, multiple healing periods, and to which patients you just make the short procedure and don't wait?
I don't think in this case that you have any other option. Mm-hmm. Because what are your alternatives? You extract all the teeth, you place implants, and have immediate loading. Immediate loading when you place an implant in a tooth socket is problematic because the tooth is not held very strong in the bone. Mm-hmm. The tooth is much larger than the implant itself, so it's a little bit problematic to have immediate loading. And in frontal areas, immediate loading is especially problematic because most of the forces are horizontal, and this is what makes the implant to move and to have a worse osseointegration. So immediate loading probably won't be the best thing. And even if you have immediate loading in this case, you still need to have temporary bridge. You still need to change the temporary bridge to another temporary bridge. Mm-hmm. You have quite hard procedure. When you extract the teeth, place the implants, you send the patient home without teeth. You need to take some impressions. And then the patient came back with, and you place the teeth.
This kind of case can be done in any other type of restoration, like cemented one?
Yeah, you can have a cemented restoration in this case, but you take out the bridge many times. Mm-hmm. Each time you take a bridge on cemented restoration, it's a little bit traumatic because you need to hit the bridge to take it out. And you have some chances of decementation and the residues of the cement have some inflammatory effect on the soft tissues and the healing. So cemented would work, but it won't be that great in this case. Because each time you take the bridge, you hit, you take out the bridge, you cement, you have excesses. Not the ideal solution.
So just to make it clear, screw retain restoration is the way to go if you want to heal the gingiva in the shortest amount of time and in the best way possible.
In the best way possible, yes. In the shortest amount of time, I don't think there'll be much difference. Mm-hmm. But the convenience of the process is a great advantage because screw retained restorations are, you can take it out, you can bring it back, you don't have any traumatic procedures, and everything is just go easy. You don't need to take out anything by force. You don't need to cement anything and clean and excessively clean. You just take it out, put it back. You have the, you're sure every time that you can take it back, because if you have the cementation, so you'll use stronger type of cement. Mm-hmm. If you use stronger type of cement, next time, maybe it won't come out that easily. In this case, the bridge can break in two.
You can use a bigger hammer.
Yeah, bigger hammer, but you break the bridge. So then, when the patient came, you need to send the patient back home. Mm-hmm. You can't send it with broken bridge, so you need to make a new bridge. You have many problematic things that, in many cases, you can't be ready for. In screw retained restoration, you can't be ready for every scenario because you take it out, you're sure you can put it back.
It helps you to avoid obstacles.
Yeah, and when you choose the multi-units in the program, it even more simplifies the work because you don't need to take out the multi-units and put them back. When the multi-unit healed, the gingiva somehow attaches to the multi-unit, and taking out the multi-unit is still a little bit traumatic process. Mm-hmm. It goes easily, but it's not comfortable for the patient. So when you can take less times the multi-units out and change them and put them back, it's great.
So, wow, that was a complicated case. In a couple of phrases, can you summarize it?
First of all, we took time. Mm-hmm. We did everything and gave the time for healing. Then we minimized the procedure we can do in the clinic. We took impressions on multi-unit level. We changed the multi-units in the laboratory. We had everything planned from the beginning till the end. So we knew how many bridges we need to do. We knew what type of multi-units we need to use. We had all the information we need, and this is how we got a great result in the end. The key point is planning and performing by the plan that you initially made.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for tuning in. See you next week. Don't forget to subscribe, like, and follow us.